1930 saw the birth of modern Grand Prix motor racing. In England, the sport was a hobby for the rich, but in Germany, Hitler used motor racing as powerful propaganda, a way of demonstrating to the world the Reich's engineering supremacy. Under his control, Germany produced racing cars that annihilated all opposition. These cars, called the Silver Arrows, became invincible gladiators across the racetracks of Europe. Closely guarded, no outsider was allowed near them, except for one. A young English racing driver called Richard Seaman. He was Britain's most successful racing driver of the pre-war era, but today he is unknown. Written out of history because he raced for the Germans. And the crowning moment of his career was celebrated with a Nazi salute. Only after Germany's defeat in 1945 was the story of Richard Seaman and the Silver Arrows remembered. As British intelligence agents searched Stuttgart for Germany's industrial secrets, they came across some blueprints, reminders of how the lure of German engineering ensnared one of Britain's most talented drivers. The cars at the centre of Richard Seaman's story were Germany's finest. Built by Mercedes and Auto Union, their engineering inspired British designers up until the 1960s. Before the war, the specifications of the Silver Arrows had been kept secret. They had been manufactured by the same workshops making Hitler's armaments. Prized by the Nazi regime, the German racing teams had orders to destroy the Silver Arrows rather than let them fall into foreign hands. When they raced, onlookers had been kept away.
You couldn't get near the pits. We were all behind curtains on that one. Very hush-hush. Oh, absolutely. It wouldn't let us know what was going on.
Yet despite the security, the young Englishman Richard Seaman was chosen to drive the Third Reich's closely guarded secret.
I should think Seaman himself was sworn to secrecy completely and never dare break that rule.
The story of Richard B.T. Seaman has remained largely hidden from British history. He was born in 1913 into a family with wealth and status. His father had made a fortune from the distilleries business and owned a vast estate in the country and a house in Knightsbridge.
He was the product of a very elderly father who'd married a very much younger but nonetheless widowed lady. And she was a rather grand lady in her own right. And she's been described as a grande dame of the stiffest corset.
Young Dick grew up with one ambition, to be a racing driver.
Fairly typically of boys of his class and his period, he barely knew his parents while he was growing up. They were hoping that he would go into the diplomatic service and then he'd eventually run for Parliament and he'd become an MP.
So, in September 1926, Dick's father dispatched him first to rugby school and then to Cambridge. But Dick's driving ambition spared little time for academic work or the wishes of his parents.
Dick had this daily resolve, and sometimes he treated his parents pretty badly, because he just ran roughshod over their wishes in order to do what he wanted and become a successful racing driver.
Dick leant on his rich parents to fund his plans to race. At 21, he persuaded his mother to buy him another car. He didn't tell her it was for racing.
Seaman already was a promising driver then. And then he went on from strength to strength. Yes, he was a very fine driver, race driver. Very calm and collected. Knew what he was doing.
Dick's professional attitude was out of step with the amateurism of the sport. Motor racing in England remained a hobby for the rich.
people just go down there and pay at the gate to go in and perhaps take a picnic lunch with them. People used to dress nicely for the occasions, especially the ladies. It wasn't quite Ascot, but modelled a little bit like that.
Dick set his sights high. Even early in his career, he looked to make his mark outside England and began competing on the continent.
He very quickly learned that because it was a profession in Europe, there was money to be made there. So from the very start with his first MG, he went racing abroad.
In the 1930s, motor racing was more dangerous than today. There were very few regulations or safety precautions. Very soon, the worry of Dick's racing began to drive a wedge between his parents. Dick's father grew so concerned that Mrs. Beattie Seaman now began to hide from him any news of Dick's motor racing, often saying that he had gone off travelling or shooting.
His mother was incredibly indulgent. His invalid father was worried about what Dick was going to do, what was going to become of Dick. The notion that somebody should actually consider dedicating their life to a sport was complete anathema to him.
As Dick's passion for motor racing grew, at home his father became more disappointed in him.
My dear boy, when are you going to settle down to your career and take it seriously? You know we always hoped that you would read for the bar and stand for Parliament or be trained for the diplomatic service. Motor racing's neither here nor there. It's just a sport and amusement and leads to nothing.
In Germany, attitudes towards racing couldn't have been more different. There, to race was considered an honour, and motor racing was about to undergo a revolution. When Adolf Hitler became Chancellor in 1933, the car became central to his vision of a new Germany.
Hitler was absolutely fascinated by technology, and he thought that technical advance would be at the core of his kind of utopian vision of what Germany was going to be. And this covered absolutely everything, cars, roads, armaments, all areas of modern technical development.
Unlike Britain, where motor racing received no financial help, Hitler allocated 500,000 Reichmarks a year to go towards the Mercedes racing program. But then along came a man who would revolutionize the sport. His name was Professor Ferdinand Porsche, and he created a rival company called Auto Union.
Ferdinand Porsche was essential to his fellow Austrian, Hitler, in the 1930s, not only in helping to develop really high-powered cars, but because he was the man that Hitler chose, of course, to produce the famous people's car, the Volkswagen.
On the 10th of May 1933, Dr. Porsche arranged a meeting with Hitler and unveiled his own plans for a new racing car. Hitler was so impressed, he now split the 500,000 Reichmarks destined for Mercedes with Auto Union. Hitler now pitted the two companies against each other. The fierce competition between Mercedes and Auto Union pushed engineering to new heights and set the template for the modern racing car. The Finnish Mercedes was shown to Hitler in January 1934, and the Auto Union car was presented to him 2 months later. Together, the two rival cars would be known as the Silver Arrows. With Hitler's financial encouragement, they stood ready to take on the world. In Britain, Dick continued to receive disapproval from his father and funding only from his mother's checkbook. But he had just one ace up his sleeve. His father's ill health meant his mother controlled the purse strings. However much he disliked him racing, Dick knew he could play upon her conscience.
Dick Seaman was Mrs. Beattie Seaman's only son, and she absolutely doted on him. And she worried herself sick that he was going to hurt himself. But essentially, he could twist her around his little finger.
Dick even persuaded his mother to buy him his own plane. Thinking it would distract him from racing, she obliged, but he used it to fly to the racetracks of Europe. In Switzerland, Dick won his first major victory, the Prix de Bern, but his success was overshadowed by the tragic death of one of his fellow drivers. The team was severely shaken and shortly afterwards disbanded. When Dick's aged father read about the accident, he got confused and thought it was Dick who had died. He suffered a heart attack and went into care.
There was a degree of selfishness and self-obsession and self-interest, which seems unattractive now, but Dick was going to be a racer, and he decided very early on that he was going to be a racer, and a racer he became.
His racing was breaking his parents, but he had no intentions of giving up. Dick was ready for the fast track. Victory abroad had fueled Dick's need to win. In 1935, he looked for a faster car, but he was still reliant on his mother for cash. Dick no longer hid his intentions. This time he asked for £2,000 and told her it was for a new racing car. Under pressure from her husband, she refused. Under more pressure from her son, she relented. Another check was written, and another car was bought. This time, Dick became the owner of Britain's finest racing car. ERA were the creation of Raymond Mays, who had a reputation for winning.
Mays was quite a good racing driver himself, was a brilliant entrepreneur. And Mays produced a number of these cars for private buyers, of whom Dick became one.
Dick was competitive, and now with the ERA team, he was expecting to win. But in race after race, his ERA suffered from engine trouble.
Dick quickly realised that he was getting second best. And what Mays had not reckoned with was a very shrewd racing brain, a very ambitious young man, and a very pampered young man who was not used to being given second best.
Dick's attitude was wearing the patience of Raymond Mays and breaking the patience of his father. When he discovered his wife had handed over £2,000 for another racing car, he threatened to write him out of his will and set off to London to stop Dick from racing ever again. But it was too late. His father collapsed and died the following day.
Mr. Beattie Seaman did threaten to write Dick out of his will if he didn't give up racing. And I think he meant it. He was distressed by Dick's racing, certainly. Thought he was wasting his life, basically.
His father's death did nothing to sway him from racing, but throughout the year, Dick's ERA was plagued with problems and he missed races. Exasperated, Dick flew to Monaco to watch the Grand Prix. The German teams were competing with their new cars. Here, he came face to face with the kind of motor racing he had always dreamed of. Dick wrote,
"The performance of the Mercedes team was amazing. The three cars arrived together with plenty of time to spare and were placed with their backs to the pits at exactly the same angle and the same distance apart. Each car had two mechanics who arranged the pit about a quarter of an hour before the start. The whole performance was like a PT squad at the Royal Tournament."
When he first saw the new Mercedes Grand Prix cars in 1935, he was seeing not only remarkably sophisticated cars that were beautifully built, but he was seeing an expression of the new Germany.
Dick had seen perfection. The German teams embodied everything he was struggling to achieve. When he returned to England, his car failed him yet again.
Well, Seaman wasn't going to put up with that and had a stinking row with Mays. I think he demanded his money back. It was always rumoured there was a bit of a hell of a row went on between them.
Dick took his car away from the ERA team. From now on, things were going to be run his way. He set up his own workshop and employed his own team of top mechanics.
He was very focused on what his engineers and his mechanics were doing, and he developed a technical feel for the machinery, which was very unusual at that time for any racing driver, and particularly for a gentleman racing driver.
Now Dick got results. He won the Coppa Acerbo Junior at Pescara, the Prix de Bern, and the Masaryk Grand Prix. It wasn't top Grand Prix level, but Dick was now known as a winner in respected events across the European racing calendar.
Dick Seaman seemed to go into a class way above the ordinary amateur racer. They went on the continent and they were always here, there and everywhere. We couldn't keep in touch with them.
Soon everyone knew where he was. Returning to England, Dick's success was unstoppable throughout 1936.
Some of Britain's most famous drivers took part in the road racing for the British Empire Trophy at Castle Donington, near Derby. Freddie Dixon, Earl Howes went screaming round the course, taking...
The old names were soon swept aside as Dick demonstrated his superior skills. He won his next two events at Donington, and then there was the Isle of Man.
The Isle of Man for a day is given over to the roar of high-powered cars. Watch number nine. Young Richard Seaman was the winner in spite of a smashed windscreen and a head cut by flying stone. Well done.
Dick's success continued abroad and caught the attention of the most influential man in motor racing, Alfred Neubauer, the team manager of Mercedes-Benz.
Alfred Neubauer was so impressed with Dick Seaman's ability that towards the end of 1936, he sent him a telegram asking him to go to Germany to test drive a Mercedes racing car. Mrs. V.T. Seaman opened it and saw that it was for Dick from Mercedes, and she knew of Dick's ambition, obviously, to join the Mercedes, and she was also aware of the worsening political situation in Germany. So initially she hid the telegram in a book and then had second thoughts about it and showed it to Dick. She must have been torn over this because she didn't like him racing, but clearly he was very good at it. So I think part of her wanted him to succeed and part of her wanted him to stop. But he was unstoppable.
His mother had already spent £30,000 on his passion. Every time he had asked for more, she had always given in. She had lost her son to motor racing. Now she would be losing him to Germany. Dick couldn't wait. After years of suffering the frustrations of British engineering, the Mercedes offer was a dream come true. Now he had to be approved by Adolf Hitler, the Führer himself. In February 1937, Dick's contract arrived. The Führer had given his approval. For Dick, there was no turning back. Dick was the only British driver to reach this level of motor racing, now monopolised by the two German teams, Auto Union and Mercedes. Dick would have to prove himself as the British junior at the wheel of a German car. He was earning a massive £3,000 a year, plus a share of the team winnings, but he was forbidden to take his money out of the country. So he had to make Nazi Germany his home, renting a chalet just 30 minutes drive from Munich.
I think when Dick Seaman first joined Mercedes in Germany, he fitted in like a round peg in a round hole. He liked them and they liked him. He was regarded as something of a curiosity by the established drivers because they all knew that Brits can't drive, you know, self-evident. But he very rapidly proved to them that he was a quick boy.
Dick was getting used to his new car, a Mercedes W125. built to win. It was Hitler's display of Germany's might. The cars could not weigh more than 750 kilograms, and the Mercedes engineering team went to any lengths to lighten the bodywork, drilling holes into every piece of metal to reduce weight. The car boasted a sophisticated chassis, independent front suspension, and hydraulic brakes. The Mercedes would have been an outright world beater, yet Hitler knew the benefits of competition. His encouragement of Dr. Porsche's auto union had produced a second, equally formidable machine.
The biggest deviation from the norm with auto union was to make the car mid-engined, i.e. putting it behind the driver instead of in front, but also in front of the rear wheels. As has been proven with all Formula One cars, it's the correct place to put the engine. Auto union and Porsche just a few years earlier.
Faced with such revolutionary competition, Mercedes' ingenuity was pushed to the limit.
Mercedes went to the nth degree to save weight in the process, i.e. lots of the castings were made of magnesium. Most of the fastenings on the car are wasted. This gets rid of a little bit of weight, and then the top there and a little divot gets rid of a bit more weight. And if you do that to every component on the vehicle, you're obviously going to make a significant difference.
But despite all these measures, the Mercedes cars were still too heavy.
When the cars were weighed, they weighed in just a smidgen over 750 kilograms. So what they did was scrape off all the paint and all the filler, and they ended up with silver cars, and that was the start of silver being the German national racing colour.
After years of British engineering, Dick found his new Mercedes offered a level of perfection he'd only dreamed of, and the power beneath his foot was exhilarating.
I liken it to a rather overpowered go-kart. You know, it is totally drivable on your right foot. You put your foot down and you sort of created a bit of smoke because the wheels spun, and if you weren't very careful, they'd spin on each gear change as well, irrespective of speed. But it's a tremendous car, and one which I have a tremendous amount of admiration for the people who drove these on the sort of circuits they drove them.
At Dick's first race in Tripoli, sand caused his engine to stutter a few laps from the end, and he was seventh. Dick's teammate Hermann Lang won, and Mercedes celebrated. This was superstardom. Dick was surrounded by the most famous drivers in motor racing. Legendary names like Rudolf Caracciola and Manfred von Brauchitsch were now his teammates. But the atmosphere between the drivers was super competitive. And his next race at the Avis Grand Prix in Berlin looked more daunting. The banked track had been specially built for speed records, and the silver arrows were fitted with special streamlined bodywork to gain extra performance from the long straights. The cars looked so intimidating that the Italians dropped out, leaving only Mercedes and Auto Union to compete between themselves. On the six-mile straights, the streamliners could reach a top speed to match a Formula One car today. Dr. Goebbels made the most of this blatant display of power. Dick battled his way up the order. He finished fifth, but he was the second fastest in the Mercedes team. After years of struggle, Dick was making a name for himself in the world's greatest race team. He soon got news that the Germans planned to race in Britain, at Donington Park. Here was his chance to prove himself on home turf. Germany was also looking forward to a resounding victory. The arrival of the Silver Arrows in England was devastating.
I always remember the crowd thinking there were miles and miles and miles of queues. But in them days, we'd never seen such a crowd. And it was, of course, the famous cars.
Dick knew the circuit better than anyone and was anxious to excel in front of his home crowd. Dick was favoured fourth at the bookies, He enjoyed seeing Raymond Mays further down the odds. The German cars left the opposition standing. And the proficiency of the pit stops were eye-opening.
It was fantastic to see them and, you know, all the same overalls where good old England, one would have a jacket on, one would have a shirt on and everything, you know, rantan. And they were all dressed up smart, all the same, and you thought, ooh, weren't they efficient?
Dick wanted to show the British amateurs what real racing was. The Silver Arrows lapped the British cars as they struggled around the circuit.
It was a different world. The cars were so advanced, and the performance and everything. It was very exciting to watch them. I know, which was something I hadn't seen done before, when they were putting thermometers on the tyres to see what temperature the rubber was. Incredible, we'd never thought of doing that. And even the tyre makers never said check temperatures.
It was a frightening speed to think of. And then when they got to the old airpin bend, you know, they used to just leap off so you could see under the wheels. Looked fantastic.
Dick was unlucky. Nudged off the track by a rival Auto Union, he was later forced to retire. But the race gave English onlookers an awesome spectacle. This time, Auto Union won. But behind the celebrations, Hitler's Grand Prix in England made the German threat very real. After the race, Dick went away to the Swiss Alps. He was enjoying the glamour of his new life. But the fears his doting mother felt for him were now underlined by the mood of the country. The British were rattled and sent the politician Lord Halifax to Berlin for talks. The power of Nazi Germany strengthened each day, and in February 1938, Dick was summoned to attend the annual motor show in Berlin. Along with his fellow teammates, he was presented to Adolf Hitler. There were speeches from Dr. Joseph Goebbels and by the Führer himself. Dick realized he was now ensnared by the Reich's propaganda machine. In a letter, Dick wrote,
"He spoke of the many daring young racing drivers who risked their lives to win prizes, not for love of their machines, but for the honor of Germany."
Being a puppet of Nazi propaganda had its rewards. Dick was at last free from the purse strings of his mother, and now his life was about to take a new turn. On June the 15th, Dick received a call from an old racing friend, Aldi Aldington, inviting him to a party. There, Dick became captivated by a young 18-year-old called Erica Pop.
It seems to have been love at first sight, and they sort of danced the evening away. And she spoke fluent English, and it all blossomed from there.
Erica was the beautiful heiress of one of Germany's respected families. Her father was the managing director of BMW. 7 years younger than Dick, Erica's good looks had put her picture in the socialite magazines. Erica was bowled over by the dashing English racing driver, and their romance over the next few months brought them closer together. In the team, the competitive edge between the drivers sharpened as Dick became faster.
As he became more and more proficient and more reliable, the team number one and number two drivers, Rudi Caracciola and Manfred von Brauchitsch, became more distant from him. The quicker he got, the more of a threat he posed to their position.
This atmosphere would ignite in the most nationalistic race event of all, the 1938 German Grand Prix.
what's this Englishman doing here? Why do we need him? What's he doing in our cars? He's an incomer. He's a foreigner.
Dick was very soon in third place and then moved up into second behind fellow teammate Herman Lang. But when Lang called into the pits, Dick took the lead. When Dick stopped for a tyre change, von Brauchitsch took over the lead. Von Brauchitsch had been the fastest in practice and favourite to win. Drivers raced to team instructions, and Dick was expected to follow the senior drivers. Dick was an Englishman in a team that had to deliver a German victory. And now von Brauchitsch was destined to win. The perfect victory. From a military family, von Brauchitsch had all the credentials. His uncle had just been appointed army commander-in-chief by Hitler.
There was no way that Brauch was not going to win the 1938 German Grand Prix until he came in for a refueling stop.
On lap 16, von Brauchitsch pulled into the pits and Dick pulled in close behind him. But then von Brauchitsch's car caught fire. Dick waited.
And you see him react to the fire ahead, and then you see a different reaction come across his face. And the different reaction is, I could win this. And he gestures, get me started, get me out. And they restart his car, and he pulls out and goes past Brauchitsch and goes off into the lead.
Dick went on to win, over 2 minutes ahead of the field.
This was rather embarrassing because, of course, this was the premier race in Germany and it was supposed to be a German victory. And here was this English driver.
Against all odds, Dick had achieved the greatest impossibility. He had won the German Grand Prix. As Europe began to fall apart, Dick's romance with Erica blossomed. In the wake of his Grand Prix victory, Dick had found happiness with his beautiful young heiress. Dick's friend Aldi and his young family came over to stay at their nearby chalet and remember the happy days they spent with Dick and Erica.
As a four-year-old, it was a lot of screaming and shouting and being dangled over a water butt, pretending I was going to be ducked and that sort of thing, which was always fun. But Erica, who's not much older than we were, certainly in spirit, she was the one who brushed us off to picnics in the fields and things, which was always very nice.
For the first time in Dick's racing career, his mother recognised the scale of his success. Mrs. Beattie Seaman set off by train for Munich to come and share in the celebrations. Dick introduced her to Erica.
She met Erica and, understandably, was bowled over by her because clearly Erica was charismatic and gorgeous and charming and lovely. And initially, Mrs. Seaman was clearly enchanted.
Mrs. Beattie Seaman was further bowled over when she was taken to see the weekly newsreel at the cinema showing her son's victory.
She was overwhelmed by the experience of sitting in a German picture house and watching the German audience's reaction to the German newsreel showing Der Engländer winning the German Grand Prix, and she was just immensely proud of him.
But the images of an all-powerful new Germany confirmed to Dick's mother all her worst fears. Her son was driving for a country heading for war. When she learned that Dick was in love with Erica and wanted to become engaged, her attitude to Erica changed.
I don't think she had anything against Erica as a person. I think it was more a hangover from the First World War and the conflict and knowing people being killed and thinking that if another war came, have an Englishman married to a German, it would cause divided loyalties and possibly some stress, but probably she was just too strict in her thinking.
When Mrs. Beattie Seaman had returned to London, Dick asked Erica to marry him. Her family were delighted. Dick's mother did everything to stop it taking place.
She realized that here was someone else who was going to keep him away from her. And she became very antagonistic towards Erica, and it all became really unpleasant.
As the two lovers grew closer together, their two countries grew further apart. Having already gained Austria, Hitler now stood poised to reclaim the Sudetenland, the stepping stone to Czechoslovakia. Britain stood on the brink of war. On September the 15th, 1938, Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain flew to Germany to meet with Hitler. For 2 weeks, Europe held its breath. In the middle of this crisis, Dick and Erica officially announced their engagement in London. Unwelcome at Dick's mother's house, they celebrated with the Aldingtons.
Mrs. Beattie objected so strongly to the marriage that they held their engagement party at our house, to which she refused to come.
No agreement was reached in the Seaman household. Dick's mother opposed his marriage and made it clear that she never wanted to see Erica in her house ever again. For Dick, marriage and motor racing were going ahead. Despite rumours of imminent war, the German teams arrived at Donington Park for the 1938 Grand Prix. But as the political crisis heightened, the cars, under a veil of secrecy, were recalled to Germany. Their teams were given orders to destroy them should war break out. As political negotiations wavered, Britain prepared for war. On the 30th of September 1938, Neville Chamberlain returned from Munich, proclaiming peace in our time. The German teams turned around and headed back to Donington. On the day of the Grand Prix, all eyes were focused on Dick. As the only Englishman in a German team, Dick's diplomatic skills now extended beyond his own family. He chauffeured the Duke of Kent around the circuit before introducing him to the German team amidst Nazi salutes. Facing such weak competition, the race was another battle between the German teams. Dick spun off the track and lost valuable time. But he clawed his way back, finishing third. He was awarded the British Racing Drivers Club Gold Star for winning the German Grand Prix. There was no praise from his mother, just an ultimatum. That if his wedding went ahead, he would not inherit anything from his father's will and could expect nothing from her. Dick's control over his mother had gone. He could not persuade her to attend his wedding. She would never see him again. Dick and Erica were married at Caxton Hall Registry Office in London on December the 7th, 1938. The event was celebrated without Mrs. Beattie Seaman. After their reception, they left for Germany to their new chalet, a wedding present from Erica's parents. Dick had a new contract for 1939, but when there were only three cars available, he was the reserve driver.
The Daimler-Benz management, possibly with an eye on the political situation, were not giving Dick drives. He wasn't getting out in the car, and when he did get out in the car, it wasn't very good.
Nazi discrimination could prevent him from racing. Dick was beginning to wonder if he should leave Germany. He wrote to Earl Howe, a friend whose judgment he'd called upon before.
Anglo-German relations having reached the stage they have, and with the future outlook not at all rosy, I am, as you can probably imagine, being forced to consider very seriously whether I ought to give up racing with Mercedes. The reasons prompting me to take this bicycle.
It was critical for Dick to keep racing. It was now his only source of income. His mother had severed their relationship completely, and with that, all finance. Towards the end of June, Dick and Erica arrived at Spa in Belgium for the Grand Prix. Dick was delighted to be in the team. Their stay in Spa was photographed for a feature in Picture Post, a day in the life of a racing driver. June the 25th, the day of the Grand Prix, was cloudy and wet. Dick appeared relaxed before the Picture Post photographer. He had much to feel relaxed about. He'd achieved everything he'd always wanted. But there was a price. Driving for the fatherland was becoming untenable. The clouds that surrounded him spelled danger. And the words from Earl Howe underlined that.
In reply to your difficult problem, the general consensus of opinion seems to be that if you can stick it, it would be very much better for you to stay where you are and continue to drive for Mercedes. On the other hand, it is of course possible that things might take a turn for the worse, and of course there is always the awful possibility of war in the background. As to this, you must be the judge. But I do not suppose that you would want to stay in a concentration camp any more than I would.
Dick and Erica had lunch together before the race. Dick was looking forward to it. He excelled in the wet. It was going to be a straight battle between the German cars. Dick was a solitary British racing driver at the wheel of a German car. A racing driver who knew it was time to be leaving. The rain was now heavy and the spray made overtaking hazardous.
Long straights, very, very fast curves, tree-lined almost everywhere. Very, very fast circuit. That 1939 Belgian Grand Prix saw the skies completely leaden with endless torrential rain. And the road was in a very, very slippery state.
Dick had been in the second row on the grid. He was soon in fifth place. And by lap eight, he was up to fourth. Caracciola, the most senior driver, was revered as the rain master for his skills in the wet. These conditions suited him, and he took the lead. But Dick was very soon behind him in second place. Then, one lap later, the rain master spun off the wet track. He was out of the race. Now Dick took the lead.
He was just going faster and faster and faster. And he was doing it better, more effectively, more efficiently and faster than any man in the world. And he was in that little bubble of achievement.
Here was another Grand Prix for the taking, just laps away. And he was determined to win. He had always been determined from his earliest days. He had fought his family's expectations. He had shown British motor racing he was the best. And now, he had to prove to the greatest racing team in the world that he could beat them. Above all, Dick had to prove to himself that he could succeed in the life he was driven to fulfill.
And then it all went horribly wrong. And he just pushed too hard, too long. Just one lap too many.
At 130 miles per hour, as he drove into Club Corner, he lost control of the car.
The car hit the trees, effectively broke in two around the tree, ruptured the fuel system in the car, which gushed fuel laden with acetone into the cockpit, and it ignited. And Dick was trapped in the cockpit in a blast furnace until some very brave guys managed to pull him out.
Severely burned, Dick was pulled from the wreckage and rushed to hospital. Erica, who had been watching the race in the grandstand, was quickly informed and taken to the hospital to be with him. There, Dick briefly regained consciousness. He explained that he had wanted to show that Caracciola was not the only Rainmaster.
He was a very good competitor, and Mercedes-Benz, irrespective of the political side, you know, wouldn't have had him unless he was a goer. You know, they were out to win. I think that no one must ever underestimate the situation in teams. Your biggest competitor is often your teammate.
Dick died shortly before midnight. Britain had lost its finest Grand Prix racing driver.
Poor Erica, you know, when she lost Dick, she was only 18. You know, she was a kid. And late in life, she looked back with enormous affection upon the short period of time that she'd been privileged to know Dick and to be his wife.
At his funeral in London, his fellow teammates from Mercedes-Benz all attended. The largest wreath was made of white lilies and measured 6 feet across. From it hung a ribbon bearing the name Adolf Hitler. As a racing driver, Richard Seaman was a talent for Britain to be proud of. But his memory was doomed by Hitler's endorsement. Instead of being remembered as a hero, his story has lain forgotten, buried beneath the carnage of the Second World War.